Sinfonia brings an incredible amount of experience, not only as an educational leader, but as a STEM educator, and no doubt she'll talk about this topic from quite a few points of view based on her range of experience. She also spent some time a little further south of here down in Beaufort for a while before coming up to the Charleston area. And Carrie Ball Hodge is also an educator extraordinaire. When I first met her, we found out very quickly we're both from Louisiana, so we had a lot in common immediately to talk about from our Louisiana roots. Carrie is the assistant principal at Knightsville Elementary School in Dorchester District 2. You can see, again, some of her credentials up here. I wanted Carrie's involvement because she's bringing in the experience of working most of her career with very young children. And what do we do? How do we deal with resiliency and issues and barriers when children are very young and getting them started as best we can at an early age? So, as I said, these are the things that we're going to be talking about today. And I put a couple of little definitions together. So, this whole symposium today and tomorrow is about resiliency. And so, it's sometimes good to define a term. And one thing you'll notice there, it talks about being stretched and being elastic, the ability to get back to the original place. And that's often what we think about when we talk about resiliency and leadership or working with children. And I won't read this entire quote to you, but you can glance at it. What is a resilient leader? And this is taken from an educational consultant who writes about leadership in schools. I will read the last sentence in this. It says, not only do resilient leaders quickly get their mojo back, but because they understand that the status quo is unsustainable, they also use it to move mountains. So I think that's a fairly good definition when we think about resiliency and leadership. And then resilient school environments. This is a really nice book. It's actually written on single-sex schools for African-American and Latino boys. They did an interesting study, and you'll notice if you glance through their statement here, it talks a lot about relationships. If we're going to help children be resilient, if we're going to have leaders who are resilient leaders to help children be resilient, we're going to have to build relationships, and that's really what this quote is all about. We'll probably also mention emotional intelligence. I know Jarek will talk about that if our other two presenters do not. The emotional quotient or emotional intelligence, EQ or EI as it's sometimes called, is obviously one of those things that we need to know a lot about as leaders. Things like emotional awareness, ability to harness emotions, and the ability to regulate emotions in order to achieve purposes. And in my remarks, I will call on Jarek to begin our conversation.
Thank you so much, Dean. Good afternoon, everyone. So we're talking about this topic of resiliency, and particularly in youth, and it can be a very complex issue. And we've obviously had some trouble untangling this complexity. We have pockets, you know, there are pockets of just outliers, you know, people who have overcome just remarkably difficult circumstances. But we don't necessarily know the secret sauce, you know, we don't have a way necessarily to replicate that. What I want to offer today is kind of some foundational kind of things that I think would be very important that a lot of people who have demonstrated some resiliency might have in common. But to kind of get us started, I want you to take a look at this slide. And I don't know, some of you might have seen this before. As quickly as you can, I want you to tell me the color you see. Top row, going left to right. Tell me the color you see. Don't read the word, but tell me the color you see out loud. Let's go. Red. Blue. Red. Red. He started off wrong. See? You all are struggling a little bit. Now, I know there are some brilliant people here at the Citadel, but you all are struggling. So here's my point. Some people are still trying to get at it. They're like, it's like, here's my point. I'm not talking today about intelligence. We spend a lot of time talking about traditional intelligence. We know whether you are, you know, an undergraduate student, a graduate student, a high school dropout, or a PhD, what I just ask you to do is very, very difficult. We know this. We know that part of your brain wants to read the word. Parts of your brain want to describe the color. We can predict that. And the reason we can predict that is because we have a good sense now. We're getting more sophisticated about how we tick, about what makes us function, what makes us work, how we process information. And so much of these challenges that we face, when we talk about issues of resiliency and poverty and difficult circumstances, it's predictable that we fall into the traps that we do based on how we perceive information. And so I am going to try to give us some information that will kind of help us avoid falling into those traps, or at least recognize when we're in one of those traps, how to get out. But again, this is not about raw intelligence. This has more to do with who we are, how we perceive information. We're good? Everybody cool? All right, so I am from a city called East St. Louis, Illinois. How many people have heard of East St. Louis? Yeah, a few people have heard of East St. Louis. East St. Louis has been described by some as the most distressed small city in America. America's Soweto, it's been called. I'm going to show you a few crime statistics. By the way, this is my house. I grew up in public housing there until about middle school. And in middle school, we moved into this house. And I don't know if you can see it on the picture, but you see next door, the house is abandoned. So just imagine the kind of things that went on at nighttime, at the house next door. But look at these statistics. I like to compare East St. Louis crime statistics with statistics of the city I'm in. And let's just look at the murder rate, for instance. These are 2014 numbers. The murder rate, USA, per 100,000 people in the population was 4.9. In Charleston, that number is 12.1. Would you be a little bit alarmed until you look at East St. Louis? It's 71.4. The rate of rapes, 28.1 for the United States, 32.4 for Charleston, so right in line, 157.8 for East St. Louis. Look at the assault number, 10 times the USA average. So I said all this not to disparage East St. Louis. I mean, this is my hometown, this is where I'm from. I wouldn't be who I am if I didn't grow up there. Some of the best people I've ever met in my life are in East St. Louis. But it was absolutely a challenging place to grow up. I mean, I was singularly focused with getting out of East St. Louis. I was talking to someone at lunchtime today, and we talked about this. My one focus as a young person was, how do I get out of here? Because life has to be better. It has to be something else out there. And I just didn't want to accept that just because I'm born here, I'm supposed to be here. That didn't make sense to me, so I rejected that. But it was a challenging place to grow up. And we often wonder, well, why is it, I get this question all the time. When I've gone to the University of Illinois, when I've gone to Cornell, when I went on for a doctorate degree, I get this question. How were you able to be resilient? How were you able to make it when so many people did? And the truth is, I didn't have a real answer. And I still don't have a definitive answer. I mean, anything that I say now is kind of my best guess. It's hard to know what I was thinking at the moment and tell you about that now. So it's our best guess. But I ran across in the 90s, in mid-90s, I ran across this article in Time Magazine by Daniel Goleman about emotional intelligence. And I said, oh, I think I have this stuff. Whatever it is, I want to learn a little bit more about this. And so I learned about it. I went, took an assessment. I indeed had above average emotional intelligence. And I've really been talking about it ever since. My background is human resources. I've run HR departments. As a consultant, I could probably consult on any aspect of HR, but I don't do that. All I talk about with the Counteract Consulting Group, all I talk about are social and emotional skills and how they're so important for resilience, for leadership, for performance. I believe it was these skills, this set of skills, that enabled me to get out of East St. Louis. I can tell you all kind of stories about people who were intelligent. I had a young person, I think it was in the 11th grade, got a perfect score on the math section of the ACT. Perfect score. Dropped out of school in the 12th grade to sell drugs. And you're like, oh, this person was silly. But if you understood this person's life and you understood what they were going through, it was their impulse control. It wasn't intellect, it was impulse control that they were challenged with. And impulse control is part of emotional intelligence. So much of what people are faced with will revolve around this battle. There's a battle between emotion and intellect. Like that battle when I told you to read the word or describe the color and part of your brain wanted to read the word. It's this battle that goes on. Almost every decision we make, there's a battle that rages to some degree or another. And it's that battle between emotion and intellect. And which side often wins out? Is it emotion or intellect that wins out most often? It's emotion. I mean, think about it. Talk about it in a different circumstance here. How many people here have dieted in the past? You've been on a diet in the past. Mostly everybody.
It starts Monday.
So he's going to eat everything in the house the next couple of days, you know? So this is what happens to so many of us. We're going to go on this diet this time. We're going to go to our class reunion or crew, whatever it is we're trying to diet for. And we go to an event, and there's this big piece of chocolate cake. This big piece of chocolate cake. This battle starts. Because part of the brain says, oh, you can't have that. Don't even look at that cake. It's not in your diet plan. The calories will blow through. You can't do it. But the part of the brain responsible for emotion, what does it say?
But it'd be so good.
Look at that cake. You got to have it. Go ahead and do it. And so you start that battle. And emotions kind of work like a bully. You know, go ahead, eat the cake. Get the cake. I don't want to eat the cake. And so you got this battle going on until intellect gives up. Intellect says, look, I'm going to leave here. I'm going to end up eating this cake. So I might as well fake. But I tell you what, I'm going to make a deal. I need to save face. I'll eat the cake today, but I won't have dessert for another 2 weeks. And so you walk away and say, look, I made this rational decision to eat the cake. It was an emotional decision. And when you're in a situation where you have difficulties and challenges and hurdles and trauma, you're in this all the time. And the problem is, we are not aware at a conscious level of how emotions are. We don't know that battle is going on. We think we're making rational decisions. And we're wired with this emotional response. We're wired that way for our survival. Our fundamental purpose is survival, right? You know, every species, the fundamental purpose is survival. And that's who we are. If right now we heard, the alarm went out, and the lights started to flash, what do we know about our hearts? It would start to race. So this is proof that we're wired to just respond in this way. Because you don't at a conscious level say, the alarm is going off, the lights are flickering, maybe there's danger. Brain, send a signal to my heart, make it be faster, because maybe some danger. You don't go through that process, right? It just happens. And so when you talk to people in difficult backgrounds who grew up in places like East St. Louis, and they've made this awful decision, and you ask them, well, why did you do that? That was not a great decision. Why did you do that? What did they say? I don't know. It just happened. So we shouldn't be surprised by some of the patterns of poverty that we see, generational poverty, some of the challenges that we see, whether it's a rural community in Appalachia somewhere or a place like East St. Louis. We should not be surprised at the patterns of behavior that we see. Everything we know about how our brains work suggests that we would see what we see in these communities. We have the intellect to solve these problems. There are researchers who know how we tick, but we don't have the emotional will to solve these problems because oftentimes we think we have the answer because we're not aware of how emotions are affected. That whole process always goes on. So you all get what I'm saying. I wanted to talk about this as a foundation, and this is probably a foundation that can serve for everything that we're talking about. What emotional intelligence, the research suggests that 90% of high performers, whether it's in a business setting or an academic setting, 90% of high performers are said to have high emotional intelligence. Only 20% of bottom performers are said to have high emotional intelligence. I'm not someone who believes that this is the magic pill. You know, you swallow this, everything. Nothing works that way. There's still so many other factors that can be correlated to performance, but we know EI is a set of factors that's important. Here's a technical definition from a company called MHS who owns one of the assessments. But in many ways, it's about wisdom. It's about wisdom. How is it that I can bring what typically happens below the surface, the parts of my brain that affects my decisions, below the surface, how do I bring that above the surface so I can do something with it, so I can control it and make some decisions? Here is one version of what emotional intelligence is. Can everybody see that okay? Now, when you start to think about things like resilience, you can see the overlap. Stress tolerance, flexibility, impulse control, I talked about, problem solving. Dr. Daniel mentioned relationships. Self-regard is critical. Self-awareness is critical. So again, this is a set of skills that we know they've always been important and they will continue to be important. These are never going out of style. Now, some researcher may come along and the term emotional intelligence may pass and there may be some marketing term, but don't get caught up in that. Look at what makes up what we call emotional intelligence, really the intelligent use of emotions. What do we know about leaders who have a high degree of emotional intelligence? What do they have in common? Well, number one, they are in tune with their thoughts and feelings. They are aware of how emotions affect their decisions. In some ways, I will always be the little boy from East St. Louis, Illinois. That's part of my worldview. I have to be aware of that as I look at things out there in the world. And as long as I'm aware of it, then I can start to understand any biases I might have. They are assertive without being aggressive. They're confident without being arrogant. They set challenging goals, and they work smartly to attain them. So they're self-actualized. They feel like they have a sense of purpose. They know why they're here. They care about and connect well with others. They oftentimes volunteer in their communities because they know it's not just about them. They can handle stress well. They can bounce back like a rubber band when they've been through something that might be fairly traumatic for other people. They're flexible. They're open to new ideas. And I can get a sense already about how open people are to new ideas as I start to tell them about me. I happen to be a vegan. So I haven't had a piece of meat in 10 years. And so when I share that with people, you can see the range of reactions. Some people say, oh, man, that's crazy. You know, oh, well, give me all his meat. You know, other people say, well, you know, why did you do that? Well, the first thing I get is, well, what about your protein? That's the first thing I get. But some people say, well, tell me more about that. I can already start to gauge by how they respond to something like that, which they don't hear every day. I can already start to gauge their level of emotional intelligence already. And finally, they're optimistic. They look forward to the future. You know, they're the kind of people that you go to them with an idea and they say, this is how this might work, as opposed to, this is how this will probably not work. And they often smile often. Now, I'm not saying that they walk around with a big smile. Look, I couldn't walk around East St. Louis just like, I probably wouldn't have made it too far, right? However, when you see people walking in the courtyard here, when you see people in the elevator, when you see people, you know, when they make eye contact with you, are they generally, you know, happy? Do they smile at you? Do they look welcoming? You can start to tell how grounded they are in their emotions. So it's critically, critically important. So all these are elements that we have seen time and time again with people who have a high degree of emotional intelligence and people who are resilient. So I'll finish with this. I know there are a lot of questions, so that's what I'm really excited about, the questions that we might have. But I sign all my books with this quote. And you talked about status quo in the quote that you used. Never accept the status quo. You know, the enemy of great is good. We have a little success. We have one story about this child who came out of this really traumatic background. Look how great they are. And they're a poster child for everything. We parade them around like a circus animal. Well, what about the 300 kids we left behind? We need to focus on them. Sometimes we focus too much on the outlier. We focus too much on the outlier, whether that's somebody who's done really good or somebody that's done really poorly. Let me say this last thing. I might have 2 minutes here. Last thing. What does a politician do? Now, you know, I'm not going to get into particular, either left, right, all that stuff. But politicians, regardless of what side, they prey on our emotions. So a politician says, oh, it is wonderful to be at the Citadel. This is such a fine institution of higher learning. I love this place. And, you know, Charleston, what a wonderful city. And I might mention some neighborhoods because I'm trying to connect, you know, with people in the audience. And let's take, what's your name, ma'am? Chelsea. Can I use you for this example? She's like, it depends, you know. So Chelsea, look at Chelsea. Chelsea, she is a true example of the American dream, and she's proof that all you need to do is work hard in America. Chelsea's great-great-great-grandparents, They came to Charleston with a nickel. Put a nickel in their pocket, and you see how wealthy her family is now. They own half of the community. All you have to do is work hard. You too can have the America. But what does the politician forget? What does the politician not tell you about? The same train, a boat, a plane. However Chelsea's great-great-grandparents came here, there were 300 other families who came here with just a nickel. And guess what?
They still have a
nickel. In real life, we latch on to the outliers. In mathematics, what do we do with outliers? I'm suggesting, just like in mathematics, they don't inform what's going on. We have to be careful about getting caught up with the outliers. Thank you all so much.
Thank you very much, Derek. And there'll be some time for questions if you want to save some for Derek for a little bit later. Sinfonia, you're up next.
All right. So from my point of view, I'm coming at it from an educator's point of view, with resilience and emotional intelligence. Having taught elementary, middle, and high school, and been an administrator at an elementary, middle, and high school, the one takeaway I would give you is give them empathy, but not sympathy. Meaning, do not feel sorry for their circumstances. Acknowledge their circumstances, but do not let their circumstances define who they are to you. Okay? So think about two things, a brick and a rubber ball. Would you prefer to be a brick or would you prefer to be a rubber ball?
Depends on the circumstances.
So depends on the circumstances. What happens when you drop a brick? It breaks. Is that brick easily fixable? What happens to the rubber ball? It bounces back, it doesn't break. You can keep using it time and time and time again. That's what we have to embed and encourage and promote in our students. The spirit of resiliency. As an educator, and I was talking to Ms. Hodgeball about this earlier, we cannot make our life experiences theirs. Me, I grew up middle class. My dad was an ex-Navy man, engineer. My mom worked at a bank. We traveled, we went on vacations. When I decided to become a teacher, in my student teaching, all of my students had my experiences. But when I actually became a teacher, none of my students had my experiences. So I had to put myself in their situation rather than putting them in mine. If you are working with children in any form, you cannot assume that their life is your life or your life is theirs. In order for you to give them that empathy instead of that sympathy, you have to take them as they are, where they are, and fill those gaps that they have. And like Dr. Conrad said, sometimes those gaps are relationships. Sometimes those gaps are mentorships. Sometimes those gaps can be something as simple as meeting a simple need. As a high school teacher, one of the things I learned to always have in my classroom, peanut butter, jelly, bread, and bananas. I wasn't hungry, but I had kids who were hungry. No questions asked. If you want to eat, it's there. Just don't leave a mess. Sometimes it's feeling that need of safety. Sometimes you will be that person that child feels that they can tell something to, that they can tell no one else. Sometimes you will feel that need of belonging. Meaning that child feels that they are a part of your classroom, they are part, you treat them as if they belong to you. And I treat all of my kids, no matter what, as they belong to you. I get a lot of mamas, a lot of hey aunties. I said, I'm not your sister, I'm not your friend. But I don't mind you calling me mama because that means you know I love you, but I will put you in your place when you need to be. And that teaches children how to be resilient. Also, one of the other things as an educator, if you're dealing with children, even if you're in any realm you're dealing with children, you have to fill those gaps first before you can move on to teach them anything. Children have to have those gaps filled. It's in order for them to say, okay, well, I have this need met, I have this gap filled, now I can absorb what you are trying to give me. And what I found the most in terms of children of poverty and underprivileged children is the access that's the issue. It's not the amount of intelligence, it's the access to opportunities that defines who they are. You have children who've never been on an escalator, children who've never been on an elevator. So in elementary school, if you have a sentence where that says the child went up the escalator to go to the store, and that child's never been on an escalator, that child has no idea what that means. So as an educator, you have to give those children those opportunities. Sometimes it's not as simple as a field trip. Sometimes you use virtual opportunities. Sometimes you use your own experiences. Sometimes you bring in speakers. Sometimes it's a matter of you saying, okay, I know my textbook says this, but guess what? This, my children can't relate to this. So I have to make it meaningful for them. As a principal, one of the things I tell my teachers, if you can relate what you're doing to the best interest of kids and the growing and promotion of intelligence in kids, I have no problem signing off on it at all, because you're giving them access. Every school that I've either taught at or been an administrator at has been a Title I school. My elementary school was 100% free and reduced lunch, meaning every child ate free and reduced lunch. Middle school experience is 75%. My current high school last year was 95%. This year is 81%. I have children who've never been out of their community. I have children who've never been to the beach, and the beach is right down the street. So when they hear stories or read texts that talk about things they've never experienced, you have to be able to make that real for children. And feeling sorry for them does not make it real. What makes it real is how you get them to make meaning of it. Also, a multicultural experience is key to any child in any environment, but especially the underprivileged child. Because in order for you to be a well-rounded, resilient person, you have to know how to interact with all kinds of people from every walk of life. You have to be able to treat the janitor the same way you would treat the president. Because guess what? Everyone matters. You have to teach them those soft skills that Dr. Conrad talked about, because they don't see those soft skills modeled at home. You have to show them what respect looks like. And you may not always get it in return. But like I tell mine, yes, I will fuss at you today, but I will love you in the next minute. Because every day you get a clean slate. When kids realize that they have a clean slate, they can bounce back from whatever happens. If whatever happens causes a rift, a permanent rift, that you have lost that child. Because that child feels that they cannot trust you to be there for them. When we also think about underprivileged children, we also have to take the word race and ethnicity out of it, because it affects all children. It doesn't matter where they're from, what color they are, what they grew up with. You have to treat all children the same and give them all the same. You have to give them your love regardless of where they came from, what they look like, sometimes what they smell like. You'd be surprised at how an adult's attitude towards a child is based on what they look like physically, not based on what they have inside. And that's the worst thing to do to a child, is to break their spirit, especially when they're young. Because children have no control over their environment. For me, becoming a principal was something that I didn't think about initially, but as I grew as a teacher, I knew I wanted to make a bigger difference in the lives of children, and I still want to continue to make a big difference in the lives of children. I want to go on after this so that I can be that person that makes those decisions that not just impact, say, a school of kids, but a state of kids, a nation of kids, things that matter to all children, not just a child or a certain demographic of child.
Thank you, Ms. Smith, and we'll turn the microphone over to Ms. Ball Hodge.
Good afternoon, everyone. How are you?
Well.
I know I'm the last speaker to stand in the way of your independence this afternoon, so I know a little bit about brevity, but I do want to share my story with you because, as Ms. Smith mentioned, that poverty and resilience comes in all forms and fashions, and I'd like to share my story with you today and why I became an administrator and why I feel compelled to stay on this platform, and I want to charge you with that same task when you leave here today. So my name is Carrie Hodge. I heard a little confusion out there. I graduated from Tennessee, and then I made it up this way, and I'll go in depth a little bit later, but I'm a graduate from the Citadel. I got my master's here and my EDS, and I want to thank the people in this room for that opportunity, because had it not been for the cohort and some of the outreach, these opportunities wouldn't have happened for me or for my family, and it indeed changed our lives. So let me see if I can work this thing. Thank you. All right, so a little bit about me. How many of you are in here, you are getting ready to graduate, you're finishing up? Okay. All right. Well, I was in your same shoes recently. This is my family. We are a party of seven. That's right, I said seven. So we have five children. They range from 17 to the age of three, and our three-year-old has some very special needs. So I understand when you say it's tough working a job, it's tough going to school, and the Citadel is very rigorous. So, you know, pat yourself on the back for being part of such a prestigious program. But I was able to do it, and so can you. So that's my celebration to you guys here. And this is where I am. I'm also a mother, and I'm an administrator. I'm an assistant principal in Knightsville. It's in Dorchester School District 2. Last year, we were the largest elementary school in the state of South Carolina. Can I get a wow? We had 1,500 students. That's huge. Like, we were operating a small community in a building that was established when? 1939. And we made it happen, y'all. I think a round of applause for that. That's pretty huge, right? If I can work with him. So, why am I an administrator? Why did I go into education? I mean, what's in it for me? I could have picked a million things, right? So my parents, they were married in 1969. This is my mom, Becky, and my dad, George. My mom, Becky, she was a military brat. She moved all over. She eventually landed in Columbia, Mississippi, and she was pursuing an education degree. And she traveled to the big metropolis of Biloxi, Mississippi, and she met this handsome guy that is my father. His name is George. Well, they were married for 7 years, and you can see 69. That's, you know, part of that little love era. So a lot of great things happened then. I came along and they got divorced soon after I was born. My dad had already been married, divorced, and he had four children before I came along. My dad has a sixth grade education. None of my brothers and sisters graduated from high school. So the fact that I'm standing in front of you today is pretty huge. But my mother, I knew I was going to cry, I'm sorry. She is my story, really. So, she was a single mom. It was pretty hard in Mississippi. I mean, you're making like $600 a month with a child with no child support, no family support. So she realized she had some hard time with that, especially, you know, I was born in the 70s. I'm a little older. Hope I don't look it. For me. She had a rough time with that and not having that family support. So I lived with my grandmother, my maternal grandmother for some time. so my mom could kind of get her bearings and get life straightened out. So I was about 2. Thankfully, I didn't remember those memories. And then I moved back in with my mother for some time. She was bartending, trying to finish up that education degree that she started. Remember before that cute guy came in the picture? So she finished up her degree, and she started teaching and realized, I just can't do this. I cannot make it. I'm not about to, you know, give in and live on any sort of system. So she sent me, she introduced me to my paternal grandmother by the age of 3. And 2 weeks later, I went to live with her. We didn't have a car. So my mother left at that time and moved to New Orleans, Louisiana. And she went to law school. Let's give her a round of applause for that. She started law school, and she bartended at night. And of course, she couldn't take care of me, because how do you do that? So she got started there. And I eventually came to live with her when I was in the first grade. And this is my picture. This is a picture of me in New Orleans, and I actually received a scholarship to attend this elementary school, because schools in New Orleans in 1984-85 weren't the finest public schools. So my mom found this school for me, and it was a great opportunity. She dropped me off on her bicycle my first day of first grade there, and I remember walking in the back through the gate and leaning against the wall. I didn't know anybody. It was the first time I'd ever been to the school. And I didn't even remember my teacher's name. And I remember the bell ringing. And all the kids went inside, and I was left there, and I remember I started crying. I barely remembered my name. I mean, I'd been through, you know, my mother coming in my life, out of my life, had a dad, didn't really know him, new grandmother, leaving my grandmother. So a lot of new experiences for me. So I remember Sister Maureen, our principal at the time, walking me in, and I could hear her. She was like kind of talking about my mom, like, what kind of mother leaves her child there in the parking lot crying when you don't know? She doesn't know where she's going. So that's how I'm greeted my first day of my new school. So I walk into first grade. It's a rough year for me. And looking back, and what I know about students with trauma, that have endured trauma, it mimics ADHD, learning disorders. So I had a hard time learning how to read. I had a hard time with vocabulary, because again, you're thinking about how many conversations that people sat down and actually had with me at that time. So I kind of muddled through my first grade year, and it came to an end, thankfully. And then I went back for the summer and lived with my paternal grandmother. And my maternal grandmother that raised me for a little while, I found out she had muscular dystrophy, a severe form of it, and so she was kind of out of the picture as far as, you know, that sense of help for us. So I was just relying on my dad's mother. So and she was a great, wonderful mother. I understand now why grandmothers are called grandmothers, because of that word grand, because they're just amazing. So, sorry, let me get a sip of water. I'm used to speaking in front of my school family, and I guess you guys are my school family, because I'm a Citadel graduate as well. So anyway, I finished my first grade year, and then I went to my second grade year, and I heard about Sister Mary Ellen. You know, these nuns, you gotta watch out for them. I heard that she was horribly mean. So I walked in, of course, I'm a timid little girl, wouldn't even say my name when I walked into the building the first time. And she greeted me with the warmest smile, y'all. And that whole entire year, I felt like it was her mission to make me feel good about who I was. She would always find a highlight in me, like, oh, I love the way you're sitting up straight, or I love the way you answered that question, or, you know, way to be, you know, following along in this lesson. And she just always highlighted the great things that I was doing. So at the end of the year, you know, in a Catholic school, you make your first communion. And this is this big church. This is where I went to school. And you can't really see it. It's not great. This Aaron Neville plays there at Christmas time. It's that large, y'all. And I'm the shy, meek little girl. And she asked me to give the opening, you know, presentation to the families that have come. And so can I do it? You think I really can do this? And she said, yeah, you can do anything you set your mind to do. You absolutely can do this. You got this. And so sure enough, I went down and I gave that presentation. The shy girl, I did this. And so I think I delivered it well, and it felt like a mile walking down that aisle. And I learned the way a bride walks. And it was it's an incredible day and definitely a game changer for me in my life. So when you talk about resilience and you think about the obstacles that you overcome and the things that you've endured, all of us have in this room, I'm sure, have experienced some sort of trauma one way or another in our life. So you think about how you overcome those obstacles and those people in your life that help you. So, moving on. All right. So, my mom is coming to a close with getting ready to graduate from law school, and I'm like her little mascot. So, sitting in a room just like this, my mom would take me to her classes when, you know, it was like in-service days or whatever at my school. I would tie people's shoestrings together, and I was getting beaten when I got home for that. So, I remember they were coming to a close, and they were getting ready to have this like huge party at Audubon Park, and it was a 5K run. You don't appreciate the story. And my mother, you know, she is a very wonderful mother, and I understand looking back all the sacrifices she had to make for me. But she looked at me kind of coldly and said, I'm going to run this race today, and I know you want to run it too, but don't expect me to wait for you. So, you know, I'll be waiting for you at the finish line. I was like, okay. And all that started coming back to me, and I found that grit. Something inside of me that said, you told me I can't do something? I'm going to prove you wrong. I came in second place and I beat most men and women in that race. I've never run a 5K before in my entire life. My mom loves to share that story with people. So moving on to We Have Arrived. This is my mom. This is not actually our car. My stepfather now, I call my parent and my mother, they went through Hurricane Katrina. And so we lost a lot of pictures. In fact, I would love to show you a picture of Sister Mary Ellen, who changed my life. I went back on my 21st birthday, and yes, I did thank her, and I celebrated with a drink with her. So, anyway, we have arrived. We got our first car. So I was no longer taking streetcars, no longer getting made fun of by getting dropped off on a bicycle. In this car, if you look down, you can see the road. And the seats moved up and down. Nevertheless, it was our car, and we got from A to B. So with that being said, I journeyed on, and my mom got remarried, and then she moved to Mississippi, and she opened up, you know, a law practice there, and our life changed. And that car, actually, going back to it, to me that represents what education can do. It changes lives. So we are all here for that purpose, because we know that's the one thing that can never be taken away from us. So I started out, I moved from Mississippi to Alabama, then to Tennessee, and I ended up finishing up college in Tennessee. And then I moved to Chattanooga with my husband, and we had a child and another one on the way, and I had an early childhood degree, and I was extremely passionate about young children. And so I had an opportunity to teach at Alphabet Children's Center. It was a Jewish cultural center. And I was so excited about that opportunity because it was like top school in Chattanooga. And so I taught there. This isn't actually that school. I couldn't find a picture of it. I taught there, and I taught like the mayor's son, and we had this thing called the Benwood Foundation in Chattanooga, which is amazing. It's a foundation that helps the inner city schools in Chattanooga. So they don't leave it just to the public school system there. The whole community gets involved and takes ownership of what's going on. In the 1970s in Chattanooga, a white flight occurred, and so as suburban neighborhoods opened up and the schools became more and more segregated. And so the public schools needed a little help, and so the Benwood Foundation jumped in, and that was partnerships with agencies, businesses, and they offered scholarships. They offered to teachers, that's right, to teachers to get your master's degree in urban education. They offered housing, and I actually was a benefactor of this. I had a $10,000 bonus and went down on a house to live in a neighborhood right next to where I taught. That was my second school. Anyway, going back to the Benwood Foundation. So, I worked with and I taught the students of the mayor of Chattanooga and people that worked in the Benwood Foundation. Worked there for a year and I realized, this isn't really for me. I love working with early childhood children, but I'm not really loving that I don't feel like I'm reaching them. I don't feel like I'm doing anything. They know their numbers. They know their colors. They know everything that I want to share with them. In fact, they can teach me some things. They've been way more places than I've ever thought about going. So I decided, and I felt compelled and driven and led to teach at one of the most difficult and challenging schools in Chattanooga, which is Eastside Elementary School. 99% free and reduced lunch. And I was kindergarten through fifth grade, and I accepted that teaching position in kindergarten. Loved it. Walked in thinking my students needed Mango and Mozart playing, and wrong. They didn't even speak English, and I had no kindergarten assistant. How many of you are aspiring teachers in here? Yeah, so that was quite a challenge for me. I didn't know any Spanish. I was a French major originally. So I quickly learned formalefia, scribi nombre. I made connections, and I got to know my kids. That was the first step. The second step is what Ms. Smith mentioned. Hard lesson for me. About all teddy bears the first day they walked in. Boy, they ran over me. They ran over me, ran right over me, because I didn't understand the difference between sympathy and empathy. I didn't hold them accountable. I felt sorry for them. And I realized that's not the kind of love they deserve. They deserve a love of teaching them how to read, write, and preparing them to be good citizens in this world. So that was my time at Eastside. I spent 3 years there. Circumstances changed my course, and I ended up here in South Carolina. So now I'm at Knightsville. Now we've dropped our population down to about 850. Still working with about 350 students in poverty. So some of the trauma that I experience on a daily basis, I marked on my hand from this morning, from a student trying to bite, kid hit me. Again, I'm early childhood. He cussed me out 50 different ways. He was in kindergarten. I fixed the toilet today. These are some of the things that I do. I deal with extreme hunger and poverty. Yes, it happens in our schools today. Students that witness abuse or are part of abuse experience it. Gang neighborhoods, I have students that have seen their father shot in front of their home. Divorce, death, some neglect, mental illness, parents deployed. We have a huge military population, and homeless. And just looking at those lists, I'll quickly let you read this while I get a sip of water. Some ways that we help students overcome or write a new narrative for their story. We want to look at that real quick. So some things that we do is, first of all, you got to capture their hearts before you ever think about capturing their minds. If you don't know them, you can't teach them. You don't know what they need. We have any school psychologists in here, guidance counselors, or aspiring? Yeah. You've got to work together with your administrators and your teachers because you're sure to mislabel them and think, man, they might be special ed. And sure enough, they probably aren't. They've probably experienced some trauma. And just like me, you know, I had a mother that was an attorney. You might not have ever known that, you know, indeed that was trauma that I was dealing with, not, you know, special ed or learning disability. So you have to really get to know your students. Build relationships with them. That's key. So if they're hungry, we reach out. We have backpack buddies. We feed our students every day, morning and lunch. They get food. Of course, everybody does, but they get free food. We offer it to them. They get snacks throughout the day. On Fridays, we pack bags for them. They go home with food because we know that's their number one need. They need food, and they need shelter so they can learn. We also have the Low Country Food Bank come in. I'm going to show you a picture of that. That's awesome. You want to write that down if you're in education. They will come to your school. So what's the one thing that students in poverty don't often get? What's that?
Fruit.
That's one of my hugest things. When I was growing up in poverty, I didn't know Santa Claus, and I didn't know fruit. So that's huge. Fruit and vegetables are huge. So that's all they deliver. That's all they bring to our school. And they we partner with MUSC and Dorchester 2 Library. So you can get a health and wellness check, you can get a library card, and you can get some fresh fruits, vegetables, and they'll do a little cooking presentation for you. And I send it out to everyone, not just our school, the entire community. Because that's another thing, when you're an administrator or you're a teacher, you need to have that mindset. I am an administrator, I'm your teacher for life. Not just because you're sitting in front of me right here today or this year. Follow them. Get to know them. That shows that you sincerely care about who they are. Because you do. Prepare your teachers. They have no idea what trauma looks like, what to look for. Even if they think they do, sometimes they really don't. Give them that darkness to light. That's just one example. Professional development opportunities. How to build relationships with kids. How to understand and believe that children are better than their circumstances and raise that bar of those expectations. Get to know your school counselors. Work closely with them. We are a team. Mental health services. We have mental health currently in our schools today, and I don't know what I would do without them. They help me in so many different levels. Every single day I'm dealing with trauma. Right now I have a 15-year-old organizing her mother's funeral. She's taking care of 4 siblings. Yes. And that's happening in Dorchester School District too. It happens everywhere. Establish safe environments. So that might be through your PBIS or ways you establish that culture within your school. You set those boundaries and take that zero tolerance from any negativity. I understand that a negative mind is never going to produce a positive environment, ever. Establish that safe environment and that culture of trust. Students, when they first come to me, they'll mouth off, this school is stupid. Man, I hate this school. I don't know what y'all are talking about. They get on to me, go off on me, and I sit them down in my office. I mean, what's going on? What's really going on with you today? They open up to me. They come and see me daily. Not because they're in trouble, just because they want to talk. They know that I'm there for them. And their teachers have the same relationships with them. And because they've established those relationships, they're able to learn. We have a full-time SRO, so we don't really need them for, you know, any reasons as far as violence or things like that. I mean, most of our kids, I hate to say, I'll hang a little candy bar in front of them. I do this, I admit. But, you know, these kids are digging in dumpsters, and I'm serious. So a candy bar is a pretty huge thing for them. And if that makes them get off the floor and go in their classroom and learn, then I'll do whatever it takes. So, but our officers are there because they go on home visits. If you're not going to show up today, I don't have time to keep calling your home. I don't have time. I'm your school mama. I want you here. I send the SROs to the house. Give them a few warnings, but then I'm done. And that's just the way it has to be. We have partnerships. I've reached out to churches. I've established mentorships to work with children in poverty or students that have experienced trauma. So they have those cheerleaders coming to their celebrations, cheering them on for their tests, establishing a growth mindset. We have something called Jog and Jagettes. So we have a character building thing with some of our girls that we've helped build. We run with them. They just ran the Shamrock Shuffle because, again, going back to that health wellness exercise, we know that that can instill that character building and a confidence for our young ladies. I would love to do it for our guys. Any guys in here that want to volunteer and help start that with me? I've been begging. We have a parent engagement center. Going back to the early childhood piece, what I would like to focus my dissertation on when I get to finish up is working with mothers and then making that connection with reading. So parent engagement center offers workshops for moms, and it also works with our 2 and 3-year-olds. We provide free books, free lessons, and this is 3 times a week. We have Rosetta Stone, we have computers, and it operates like a library. You can check out awesome book bags, welcome materials. And you don't have to be a member of our public school system to come and utilize these materials. We offer free vision and hearing screenings. Again, we partner with MUSC. We have Chillax Club, Lego Therapy, we have every kind of club you can think of. And we have Future Fridays that focus on a growth mindset. So I'll show you a little bit about that, just a little snapshot of our school. I love it. Our mission and vision can be summed up in 3 words, love, learn, and lead. We used to be on the watch list from the State Department about 7 or 8 years ago. We are now, Dorchester District 2, of course, is in the top 10 for South Carolina, and I'd like to say that Knightsville Elementary is in the top 5 for our district now. And I believe firmly that because we focus on that word love first, then we focus on their learning, and then they become leaders. So we have our Jog and Jagettes. We celebrate children any opportunity we can, with terrific kids, etc. That's us throwing our graduation caps in the air because we're showing them what they can be. I have the Citadel posted all over outside my door, Tennessee, so our kids know you began with the end in mind. Just because you're a kindergartner, I expect you to be thinking about where you're going to school. We celebrate our veterans. Huge. We had 400 veterans come through our school. We did a huge presentation for them because, you know, we know a lot of the trauma that our students, you know, exhibit or show or experience, excuse me, are, you know, their parents are deployed. Here's a picture of Low Country Food Bank. It's amazing. You should see how much food that comes to our school. Christmas time, I know it's a particularly difficult time of the year for them. We provide them food. We provide gifts. Because I was that girl that asked why Santa didn't come to my house. I will not let the children in my building ever ask that question. So, we go Christmas caroling. We go to their neighborhoods. We pass out things. So we believe at Knightsville that children are definitely greater than their circumstances. I'm wearing slime right here. Let my children slime me for good behavior. Again, whatever it takes, that's my motto, that's my mission, and I'm not giving up. I send home positive postcards. 850, I write them, that's right, because that's what they deserve. So, if you have any questions, comments, it's my direct line of communication. I would absolutely love anyone in this room that feels compelled to help. Ms. Smith started us with our lasting impression of public education. I'd like to challenge you to start with our first impression of public education, because this is where it starts. We need your help. We do. Thank you.
Thanks to all the presenters, and they are actually right on time with our schedule, so appreciate their being attentive to that. We have plenty of time in the schedule for questions and answers. We invite anyone who wishes to speak up. You may address your question to any one of the panelists or to them as a group. So we'll start whoever has that first question. I know it's always the hardest, so we'll go right to the second question. And whoever has that second question to ask,